193, and Septimius Severus has just defeated his rivals and brought an end to the civil wars which were a part of the Year of the Five Emperors. He was the first emperor of the Severan dynasty, and this dynasty saw a shift in how powerful the military was. During the Severan dynasty's rule, senators in Rome were sidelined in favour of generals called legati, who were now in charge of running many aspects of the empire. During the turmoil, Britain, or Britannia as it was known then, was subject to raids from north of Hadrian's Wall, so Emperor Severus paid a visit to Britain in 208 in order to conquer Caledonia once and for all. His arrival meant that Londinium and Eboracum underwent major public works so that they could house the emperor and his imperial government. Severus went north, strengthened Hadrian's Wall, and went campaigning in Caledonia. Despite heavy losses, Severus was victorious, and by 210 he'd expanded Roman control to here. Roughly 5 seconds later, the Caledonians revolted against Roman rule, and Severus prepared another campaign, but fell ill shortly after it began. He returned to Eboracum and died in 211. He was succeeded by his sons, Getter and Caracalla, the latter of which continued campaigning in Caledonia but eventually withdrew. Caracalla's campaign would be the last time Rome would advance beyond the Antonine Wall. Getter and Caracalla ruled as joint emperors, but Getter found himself somewhat murdered before the end of their first year, and the empire went to Caracalla. Caracalla is most famous for two things. First, he was crazy, and second, he granted Roman citizenship to all free males, barring some exceptions, across the empire in 212. This brings an interesting point on how to refer to the people of Britannia during this period. Many historians use the term Romano-British, since it recognises them being Roman citizens, but also doesn't diminish the fact that many outside of the towns were not Romanised. After Caracalla, there was a period of stability until 235, when the Emperor Severus Alexander was assassinated, which ushered in what is known as the Third Century Crisis. So, the crisis of the 3rd century was a period of about 50 years when generals would one after the other declare themselves or be declared emperor. The legions they commanded would march across the empire to defeat rival claimants. This was massively destabilizing, and many provinces were ransacked by legions and often left defenseless from barbarian incursions. Britannia was slightly different in that there is little evidence for mass plundering, and archaeological evidence shows that during the last few decades of the 3rd century many villas were still being built. Ultimately, the crisis is a very complicated period, but needless to say it was extremely damaging, as evidenced by the fact it contained the Year of the Six Emperors. During the crisis, Britannia often found itself split from the rest of the empire. Between 260 and 274, Britannia and Gallia were a part of a separate empire called the Gallic Empire, but it was eventually reconquered. A few decades later, a naval commander called Carausius declared himself the ruler of the Britannic Empire, which included roughly these lands. Carausius was assassinated by one of his own men, Alectius, in 293, but Alectius himself was defeated 3 years later by Caesar Constantius Chlorus, and Britannia was reincorporated into the empire. The crisis of the 3rd century was ended primarily by a man called Diocletian, who created a form of government called the Tetrarchy, meaning rule of four. The empire was thus ruled by four emperors, two senior emperors called Augusti, and two junior emperors called Caesars, whom the empire was split between. Unlike the early empire, whereby there was some social mobility, such as rural farmers and artisans being able to move to urban centres, Diocletian made efforts to control the movement of people and skills. He did this by making ties to land and some jobs, such as being a soldier, hereditary. He also attempted to regulate prices on certain goods across the empire. In Britannia, the prices of beer and rugs were controlled in order to stabilise the economy, but this failed miserably since people just traded for these goods instead of using money. Though, to be fair to Diocletian, nobody understood economic concepts such as inflation back then. Another one of Diocletian's reforms in Britannia was to divide it into four provinces from its previous two. These provinces were grouped into larger administrative units called dioceses, and it was run by a vicarius, which is the root of the word vicar. The reason for the splitting of the provinces was to make sure that it would be more difficult for the governors of these provinces to usurp the throne. So Constantius, having previously defeated Alectius, returned to his duties as Caesar before his elevation to Augusti in 306. Constantius, like most emperors, wanted glory and so looked to a potential conquest of Caledonia to provide it because all of the previous attempts had gone so swimmingly. Constantius went north of Hadrian's Wall and defeated the people who lived there, called the Picts, in battle. Unfortunately for him, he could not finish this conquest since he fell ill and had to return to York. Before he died, he recommended that his son, Constantine, be declared Augustus by the army after his death, which they did. It was easy for Constantine to be accepted as emperor because, much like during the reign of Septimius Severus, the Roman government had travelled to Britannia with Constantius. There was one problem with this, though. There was already an agreed successor to Constantius, Flavius Severus, who was murdered in 307. So shockingly, once again, the Roman Empire was now in crisis. Constantine, through political manoeuvring and a fortunate victory at the Battle of the Milvian Bridge in 312, secured his position, but not before his famous conversion to Christianity. Constantine managed to oust the other emperors, and by 324 he was the sole ruler of the empire. Just because the sole emperor was Christian did not mean that the empire's provinces automatically became majority Christian. The process of Christianization in Britain was a slow one, but goes back much further than Constantine. There is little evidence for widespread Christianity before the 3rd century. One of the most famous Christian stories from Roman Britain is that of St. Alban, the first British Christian martyr. Long story short, Alban, or Albanus, sheltered a priest fleeing persecution and converted to Christianity. He was arrested and refused to abandon his new faith, and thus was beheaded at Verulamium, which bears the name St. Alban's. Certainly, though, by the mid-4th century, there was a sizable Christian population in Britain. So, Constantine died in 337, and the empire was split between his sons. Britannia went to Constantine II, who managed to swiftly get himself killed by his brother Constans, who then took over the western half of the empire. In 350, Constans took the time to be murdered after one of his generals, Magnentius, declared himself emperor and seized Constans' share. Magnentius would only reign for 3 years before being defeated by Constantine's last living son, Constantius. Because Magnentius had the support of Britain, and Constantius believed many of his supporters had fled there, he ordered that they be hunted down. The man ordered to do this was a civil servant named Paulus. Paulus earned the nickname Catena, which is Latin for chain. This was due to Paulus's penchant for chaining suspects and dragging them through the streets. Paulus was only tasked with hunting the supporters of Magnentius, but quickly began to prosecute notable families on trumped-up charges. Those found guilty were imprisoned, exiled, tortured, and notably had their property taken from them. An important side effect of the destruction of many wealthy families meant that public works such as city walls, roads, and temples were much less likely to be undertaken. Another major destructive event for Britain occurred in 367 in what is known as the Barbarian Conspiracy. This was a well-planned series of simultaneous attacks by different groups of people. Britannia was attacked by the Picts, the Atacotti, no one knows where they came from, and the Scots, who were from Ireland or Hibernia as the Romans referred to it then. Gaul was also attacked by the Franks and another group of people called the Saxons, who will become important shortly. These attacks, despite their ferocity, were thwarted by the general Theodosius, who subsequently oversaw the rebuilding of Britain's defences. Over the closing decades of the 4th century, Britain was involved in another imperial crisis. Shocking, I know. This was when a Roman general called Magnus Maximus defeated the Picts and declared himself emperor in 382 because everyone else did it, so, you know, why not? He was defeated by the Emperor Theodosius the Great in 394, who himself died the next year, which marks the permanent split between the east and western halves of the empire. Over the next half a century, the Western Roman Empire, now under the rule of Emperor Honorius, was divided and strained by near-continuous civil strife and foreign invasions. In Britannia, this came in the form of the Picts and the Scots raiding down the coastlines. Much of what happened during the early 5th century is hard to determine, but it is certain that Rome, more accurately Ravenna, which was now the capital, began to lose its grip on the provinces, including Britannia. After 402, there is evidence for a massive slowdown in the imports of coinage from the rest of the empire into Britannia, which means that the soldiers and civil servants who worked there were being paid from local sources and not the central government. It should be remembered that it was not just the legions which relied on payments of coinage from the government, but also those who sold goods to the legions too. It goes without saying that any downturn in payments for the legions would result in an economic hit to the entirety of Britannia. In 406, Britannia saw a quick succession of three usurpers to the imperial throne, because why only have economic collapse when you can have revolt too? At this point, the central Roman government couldn't respond very well since they were busy being overrun by barbarians. The final usurper, called Constantine III, declared himself emperor in 407 and was quite successful. He conquered Gaul and Hispania from Honorius and pushed back the Germanic invaders. In order to do this, he withdrew most of the military from Britannia, leaving it pretty much defenceless. The Picts, the Scots, and the Saxons leapt on this weakness by launching devastating raids. The civil administration of Britannia wrote to Emperor Honorius asking to be allowed to arm themselves to fight off the invaders, which he granted in what is known as the 410 Rescript of Honorius. Some consider this rescript as the Romans abandoning Britannia to its own fate. It should be remembered that the people of Britannia were still Roman citizens, and many of those who lived in the cities would have identified as such. It is likely that to Honorius, him granting permission for citizens to arm themselves was a temporary measure and not the abandonment of a province which had been part of the empire for nearly 400 years. So, this rearmament worked at first, and the Romano-British were able to win some victories. However, after continued raiding, economic downturn, and the collapse of the civil administration, Britannia fell into chaos. This economic downturn can be seen in many ways. Pottery production came to a crashing halt, coinage and a money-based economy continued to decline, urban centres were depopulated and countryside villas were no longer being built. Without a functioning economy, there was no way to pay the administration or the army, and without anything to hold the provinces together, Britannia fractured and would never again be under Roman jurisdiction. I hope you enjoyed this episode and thank you for watching. There are some recommended books in the description below, and if you have any questions, feel free to ask.